The Word of God has a question, and it says, to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Some people don't understand this kind of language. To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? But you see, if you're going to know something about the hand of God or the arm of the Lord, you're going to have to allow revelation to come into your life somehow. You don't just stumble onto it and walk away and find yourself safe and secure in the arms of God. But you must want this enough that you ask for it. Jesus in his teaching said, ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door will be opened unto you. He said, he that asketh, receiveth. He that seeketh, findeth. To him that knocketh, to him the door will be opened. That's very simple, but there is something to do on your part. You don't just sit around and wait on God to do it all. He did everything that God needs to do in order to make it possible for whosoever will. But remember those words, whosoever will, very important words. There has to be a willpower on your part, a willingness to give in to God and God's plan. Whosoever will may come and drink of the waters of life freely. That's the word of God. Whosoever will. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever will should not perish, but have everlasting life. Will you turn your life over to Jesus? You may ask, well, how do you do that? Well, first thing you do is ask yourself the question, do I believe there's a God? Do I really believe it? Then if you believe it, say you believe it. Confess it. Acknowledge it. Say, yes, I believe there's a God. And then, because you believe it, start searching for him. He's easy to find. He's nearby. As soon as you start your search for God, he'll start making himself known to you. You'll find him in places where you really maybe have never looked before, and yet he's been right there nearby all this time. One song says, he was there all the time, waiting patiently in line. Yes, he's been there when you were putting other things first in your life. He was there, waiting on you to acknowledge his presence, his existence, and invite him to be first in your life. He's still there right now. He is there, closer than a brother, a friend. He knocks at your door. He's seeking for you. He's asking, will you come and follow Jesus? Will you put your trust in Jesus? If you truly do believe and you truly are acknowledging that he is there for you, then you'll be willing to say, Lord, help me. Lord, help me to repent of my sins. He has commanded us that we should repent of sins, but he wouldn't have commanded that of us if it were not possible. If it were impossible for you to repent and come clean with God, God would not have required it. He requires it because he's willing to help you to be cleansed and free from sin. He never requires anybody to do anything that God cannot do. So if you do believe, then repent of your sin. Say, I'm sorry for the sins I've committed. I'm sorry that I'm a sinner. Then turn your face and your heart to God. Turn away from sin. And God will help you to go even farther, beyond repentance. He'll help you to understand that you must be born again of the water and of the Spirit. He'll help you to realize that you must be baptized in the lovely name of Jesus Christ. Because Christ taught us that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name, beginning at Jerusalem. It started in Jerusalem. Peter preached it on the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, verse 38. When the people gathered around and said, "What shall we do?" the answer came in the preaching of Peter. And with the 11 other apostles standing in acknowledgement that he is right, in agreement, in one accord, Peter, standing with the 11, said to these people who were asking, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, even unto as many as the Lord our God shall call." And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. May I echo that warning and that admonition today. Save yourself from this world filled with terrible, terrible crime and confusion and complex situations, family problems, and murder and rape and people hurting one another. Save yourselves from this untoward generation. How do I save myself? Believe God enough that you're willing to obey God. Believe him, repent, be baptized in Jesus' name. Then what, you may ask? Then God has a gift for you. He wants to give you his Spirit, the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. Mary, the mother of Jesus, experienced it in the upper room. She was there when 120 had gathered together to receive the promise that God sent. Mary and all the others, Peter, James, and John, and Matthew, they all spoke in tongues as the Spirit of God came upon their lives, as the wonderful Holy Ghost took up its abode in their hearts and lives. That experience they received is still available today. God has poured out his Spirit upon all flesh. And according to the prophets, and according to Jesus, and according to the apostles, you can have it. It's available. It's yours. And yes, we're living in the last days, and we are in perilous times. But the gift of God is still just as abundant as it ever was. Repent of your sins. Be baptized in Jesus' name. And let God give you the marvelous gift of the Holy Ghost. And ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. We want you to come to visit us in the New England School of the Bible to learn more about this precious truth. We teach it, and we believe it, and we know that we have found it in the Word of God, not only in the Word that's in our Bible, but in the Spirit that inspired the Word that has come into our lives. Would you come to 225 Central Avenue, 225 Central Avenue, the Greenville section of Norwich. Learn more about this wonderful truth that will set you free. We meet on Tuesdays and Thursdays at 7:30 p.m., on Sundays at 10 a.m. and 6 p.m., the Church at Norwich, New England School of the Bible, 225 Central Avenue, where you can learn the truth.
4 years ago, I was basically wandering around brainless, or should I say just filling my brain with anything I could. I was chasing a rock group around the country, doing lots of drugs and alcohol and the whole scene. Just basically lost in a world of sin is what I came to find out is what it was. To me then, it was a way that many people seem to want to go.
What would you have thought about a group like this 4 or 5 years ago, getting together in front of a television camera to talk about Jesus?
What would I have thought 4 or 5 years ago? Uh-huh. Then when I saw, if I ever saw something like this, which I don't believe I truly saw this, but what I would have seen is something Hollywood did on TV, mm-hmm. or heard about through a grapevine, and it would have been what we would have called a cult.
Oh.
for the most part. 4 or 5 years ago, when I was chasing one of the biggest cults around, doing cult things and not realizing it, I would have had the nerve to call this group of people a cult.
Well, you know, in the Bible, the devil people call Jesus a devil.
Yeah, I know. That's something I hold on to now because I've been called a devil since then.
People that have false doctrine tell people the truth, they have the false doctrine.
And, yeah.
That's, you know. Miss Jennifer, tell us who this man is in your life, what he means to you.
That's my husband.
Uh-huh, all right. How long have y'all been married?
10 months.
10 months.
Yep.
You know, that 4 years ago wouldn't have seemed possible either.
No.
Tell us a little bit about your life the last 3 or 4 years.
Well, about 4 years ago, I was a freshman in high school, and I went between, I bounced back and forth from living with my dad, which meant I went to church on church nights, and living with my mom, which meant I did just about anything I wanted to do.
Right.
And I would go to school and try to be somebody that I thought my friends wanted me to be. And then I'd go to church and pretend to be in church, you know, kind of sit there. And basically, I just sat there. But about 2.5, 3 years ago, I decided I needed a change. I felt like I was going down the wrong road. Not into drugs or alcohol or anything like that, but I don't know, the void got so big.
Right.
And that void was God. And I came to church and I got the Holy Ghost, and here I am. My whole heart given over to Him.
And so now, Mike not being in church, and you being in church, how did you two get together?
I met him at church.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. You remember those moments when it seemed like it would be impossible, or?
Yeah.
Or did you think really, when you first met him, that he'd be the man of your life?
Well, when I first met him, I liked him a lot, but I was at a stage where I was going looking for a boyfriend, nothing else. And I'm glad I didn't get together with Mike at that stage, because we wouldn't be a married couple today.
And how did you come to know Jennifer, Mike?
Through church, the same way.
Sound like we're running a dating game over there, right? But no, that's not what it
no.
is.
No.
What I found is at that time when we met, when I first started coming to church, she was already there.
Right.
I had a real experience with God. You know, I did what the Bible said to do. I experienced repentance, turning away from what I knew and what I had always lived in. Mm-hmm. It's like a realization of what you were in, or the mess that you're in, and turn from that and said, Lord, I need your help. Mm-hmm. You know, I need you, period. There's no bottom, no, nothing else. And continued on to do what he said to do, and that's to get washed by his blood that he provided for me, to be cleansed, and continued on to be raised and to be a new creature, which is the Holy Ghost, which is unexplainable yet undeniable.
And what I'm gathering from what you're saying is you didn't come to church looking for a girlfriend.
Oh, no way.
But you came to church looking for God.
Yes, sir. I came to church wanting to know whether God was real.
Right.
Because I had come to a point in my life where I just didn't care about anything anymore, not even a girl.
Right.
I had very lustful ways in the world, and I didn't care about a girl in the way that a man should care about a woman, I guess, is the proper way to put that. I didn't care. And then I got past that of just not caring about anything. I needed to know whether God was real, because if God wasn't real, I came to a point of not, I feel as though the next step would have been just to say forget it,
right,
once and for all. But I thank God that I came to a place where I was able to truly find out that God is real and that He really loves me. And for a long period of time, when I first met her, I was not interested in her in a way of more than wanting to be her friend, because I was getting rid of my past.
Right.
And it was, you know, fading away from me. And it wasn't until quite a while going to church and just really getting settled into to serving God with all my heart that I was able to start showing affection and saying that, you know.
Jennifer, do you believe that you would have married Mike had he not been in church?
No.
Why?
I didn't like people like him.
And you just don't think it would have worked out if he
no.
hadn't been in church?
No.
Well, now, is it a rule that you can only marry people that are in church, or is this something that comes from your heart?
It comes from my heart.
Right.
I wouldn't want to marry anybody that wasn't in the church.
But you married Mike, and your common ground is you both love God.
Right.
You know, I found out that a marriage built on the love of God, when people truly love God, that kind of a marriage, if both people put their trust in God, they can usually trust each other. And I've also found that if any one of those two people who want to live together, if one person leaves God out of their lives, usually there is a tragedy in the marriage. I had one gentleman come to me and he said, "Now I want my wife back. She had left him." And he said, "I want her back, and I want you to pray that God will send her back." And I said, "Let me ask you a question. Do you want God in your life?" He said, "I want my wife back, and then we'll talk about that." It doesn't work that way. If you want God, then we can talk about the other things that we need. But the Word of God teaches us, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And we have here an example, Mike and Jennifer, with somebody that sought God first, right?
Right.
And you found each other.
Right.
Now, at this point, what do you do now when you get into a situation where you disagree about which way to go?
We look to God like we did in the beginning.
So
it's like returning to your first love.
Well, now, is God on your side or is God on her side?
Well, we have the same common ground, and that's Jesus mm-hmm. Christ. And we don't lean on each other's, you know, we don't. It doesn't come down to am I right or is she right.
Uh-huh.
If we're in that kind of predicament, then we both need to look to Jesus and say, we know you're right. What do you want us to do? And then if we're truly looking to Jesus Christ in everything that we do in uh-huh. situations like that, then we will be able to both look to see which way to go, because he'll let us know, and we'll know because we're serving the same God. I try to explain that to people all the time about basing our love in Christ and how we both love Christ with all our hearts mm-hmm. and that was established once and for all before we came together, so that we don't have to lean on each other, we lean on Him.
Would you say that you have a healthy marriage at this time?
Yes, I would. I would say that we have a healthy marriage. And
do you agree with that, Jennifer?
Mm-hmm.
Did he make you say that?
No.
I admit it. I bicker at her sometimes,
mm-hmm.
and but that's, I always end up looking at her and telling her I'm sorry, and in a sense of, as soon as I do it, it's like, why did I do that for?
So you're not saying that you're absolutely faultless.
Oh no, I'm not saying that I'm faultless. I'm not saying that I'm sinning,
mm-hmm.
because that's not of God, and we don't sin.
But you do have those
but
moments
I have
of
faults. Faults,
problems,
as in,
yeah.
yeah, faults, I guess you could say faults, humanity, my flesh rising up
right.
where it needs to be put down and kept down.
I've found that to be able to base a life of any kind, whether it be a married life, single life, whatever you're doing in life, if you're able to say, Jesus is my foundation, no matter what mistakes we make or what problems we get into, we can usually get everything worked out because Jesus is the answer.
Right.
He's the answer. Is he your answer?
He's my answer.
Are you saved?
Yes, sir.
How did you get saved?
I repented of my sins. I got baptized in Jesus' name for the remissions of those sins, and I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. And more than that, I live an upright life before Him.
Do you believe that in order to be saved, you have to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ?
Mm-hmm.
Do you believe in order to be saved, you have to accept Christ as your Savior?
Yep.
Do you believe in order to be saved that you must believe that He died and rose from the grave and is still alive today?
Yes, sir.
That you went on and repented and you were baptized in Jesus' name and received the Holy Ghost?
The Bible tells me to.
Do you believe that a person can be saved without the Holy Ghost?
No, sir.
Do you agree with all that?
Yes, sir. 100%.
Do you have the Holy Spirit?
Yes, sir.
How do you know?
He told me so.
He did?
Sure.
I just walked into your house and said, hey, Mike, you've got it, right?
Well, he kind of, I guess you can say that.
Explain to us. What happened when you received the Holy Ghost? I mean, you obviously you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, right?
Yeah.
You accepted Christ as your Savior.
Mm-hmm.
You confessed Him with your mouth and from your heart that He is Lord of your life. You did all those things, and according to most churches, that means you're saved, right?
That's what they say.
That's what they say. But we're talking about going on and to an experience in God, right?
Right.
Where you've got something beyond saying, I believe or I accept.
Right.
You've got the Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost.
Tell us about how it happened.
Okay, my experience that I can see that relates to the Bible, in a physical experience, uh-huh. that I don't know how to explain it. I've never really been able to explain the actual experience of receiving the Holy Ghost that I know of was approximately 3 years ago, a little over 3 years ago now. And it was when we were going to church, my friend got me to come to church. And it was during a testimony service, which is when people stand up and they tell about the good things that God's doing with them
right.
and others around them.
Right.
And I didn't know what the Holy Ghost was, mm-hmm. but I just was told that you can have the Holy Ghost.
Right.
And what I was going on then was that this same greater than a voice was dealing with me mm-hmm. and had led me to this place and this point, and I had reached a place of this is it, this is where I want it. It's like I've been wanting to give myself to something so bad,
right.
and if I'd ever tried before, I only got hurt,
mm-hmm.
and or it just didn't feel right. That's what I felt like was going on in my life. Well, I found a point and a place that for some way God had a way of dealing with me that was able to get me to release myself to Him,
right.
and I was able to willingly say, Lord, what I said to the people, I remember saying, I don't know what the Holy Ghost is, but I want it. And I received the Holy Ghost there, spoke in other tongues as God gave the utterance. And that was a surrendering. I don't know when I actually received the Holy Ghost. That's
right.
an experience
right.
that I know shows, if anything, people around me that I spoke in other tongues.
Right.
It was going along after that. I mean, I've heard of people speaking in other tongues and then not having the Holy Ghost.
Right.
You know, speaking in other tongues and doing ungodly things at the same time. That does not make sense to me because that's not what the Bible teaches.
Right.
But we are known by our fruits. I believe that's what the Bible says. So it was a continuation. It was not only the initial, or what I to know is supposed to be the initial, was the infilling of the Holy Ghost shown by speaking in other tongues.
Mm-hmm.
That was like a physical manifestation, something that took place that people around me could see.
Right.
Something's going on between Him and God right now.
Yeah.
And it was to continue watch that life and see what comes forth to see whether that really is the Holy Ghost.
Right. That's beautiful. So you're saying that there's more than just saying, I speak in tongues.
Oh, definitely.
There's a life to be lived.
The speaking in tongues is, it's something that, it's a comfort to you to know that that's God, that's real.
Uh-huh.
And it's also something for the people around you to say, hey, there's God working on a soul that wants to be completely surrendered unto God.
When you received the Holy Ghost, were you praying that God would let you speak in tongues?
No, because I didn't even know what it was. How can you pray for something you don't know
what
it is?
So you were just praying for God to be in your life.
Yeah, I just want God, that's all.
And so He came and He brought his sign with Him, right?
Yeah, that's about what it comes
down
to.
That's what the Bible says.
Right?
These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall speak with new tongues. Doesn't it say that?
It sure does.
Did you
right.
speak in tongues?
Yes, I did.
Is that the ultimate goal? I mean, just to get to speak in tongues?
No.
But beyond that, there's a life, right?
Right.
By the fruits you shall know them. We've been talking to Mike and Jennifer, and this is the New England School of the Bible, and we hope you'll keep watching us. We come your way every week on this station, and God's blessing the church at Norwich, 225 Central Avenue, and we'd like to invite you to come down. Be with us right away. Church at Norwich, 225 Central Avenue in Norwich, Connecticut, meeting on Tuesday night at 7:30, Thursday night at 7:30, and on Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock and Sunday evenings at 6 o'clock. And thank you, Mike and Jennifer, for being here.
Thank you.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arm. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arm. Yes, I'm leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Well, I am leaning, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arm. Well, I have blessed peace with my Lord so dear, leaning on the everlasting arm. Yes, I'm leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Yes, I'm leaning, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm.
Thank the Lord for all the goodness that He's done for me. There was a time that I was lost in sin, and I really didn't have any positive direction. Oh, I had some goals, and I had some things that I wanted to do, and I had some things that I really desired to accomplish in my life. But somehow those things were empty, and they didn't have any fulfillment in them. But then I met a Savior who was able to clarify everything that I had ever wondered about, and He was able to bring to light everything that I was ever curious about, and He was able to give me so much more than that. He was able to show me that I was in sin and that I was darkness, but in Him He showed me that I could become light, and I just thank God for delivering me from sin and for causing me to be able to be lifted up into a heavenly place with Christ Jesus.